Okay, I'm live and direct from the big green couch with Paul Morris, aka Marlowe Films, aka Stan's Fine Man, but thanks very much for asking, aka the writer, director, cinematographer, editor, actor, and composer of Angry Young Men, which premieres at this year's Glasgow Film Festival. Thanks for doing this, Paul.
Thanks for having me. That's a good blast for the past day, Stan.
I know, it's been a while since I've watched that one, but it's in a place close to my heart. So yeah, you're here, you've got a film that's premiering at the Glasgow Film Festival, kind of sitting alongside films with exec-produced by Martin Scorsese, the new Sean Baker film starring Mark Rylance, some Oscar nominees this year, and films with, you know, kind of interest in world cinema. So what I wanted to do was kind of just go back and go through the journey that really got you to this point. So yeah, I think first thing, looking at from the outside, following you on social media and stuff like that, I feel like it seems to be you've got here from a mixture of two things. A love of cinema and an enjoyment of making your own videos, you know, sketches, spoofs, even a music video, the one I referenced there. So I really wanted to start with that and just probably love of cinema first. Like, how did that begin?
I think a lot of things obviously make sense after the fact. Do you know what I mean? You think, oh, that makes perfect sense. But at the time, you're like, I wouldn't have seen that. So even though, like, everyone, you rent videos and you sort of see all different ranges of films, you didn't think that was, it's not that bizarre. I mean, everyone does it. Everyone got their blockbuster story that's our generation. Do you know what I mean? So that didn't really feel that strange. But when I look back, my sort of dad's influence, I think it was where it probably started, and seeing a range of, because he was a bit older and he was like English, and he also taught, he was a lecturer at the Open University. I think his course was like media, and he also did like classics and all that, so he was always like great storyteller, great films, but also films that we could like. It wasn't dead esoteric like, oh, here's a silent film. I mean, it was like Singing in the Rain, Marx Brothers, the Coen Brothers, Richard Pryor Live in Concert. We had like a huge mix of films we'd watch. So I suppose early days, just loved watching films like a lot of people. But then later on, leaving school, I was doing a writing course, and then I was sort of like, I don't know what I want to do. Is it writing? Is it, because like you said, I was making my own stuff, doing like wee sketches and stuff. It's like, what, am I an actor? Like, I'm writing my stuff and I'm acting. So I'm like, where do I fit in? So you're trying to look at other people's stories and saying, right, is this the route I should go down? I was like, well, my stuff's sort of comedic, so am I a stand-up comedian? So I tried that, and I was like, this isn't the way I should be. And then I was like making stuff from my DSLR, and then I was just like, you go through, you know, like, who are the best directors ever? Do you know what I mean? So you're like Fellini, Kurosawa, Bergman. So you go through their box set or whatever, and you're like, this is amazing. And then you start looking at more stuff, and you start appreciating different parts. So I suppose there was an early influence, but then in later life, when I started like trying to get your own identity and what you wanted to do, then I started like really appreciating films and seeking them out myself, and then going back to the ones I saw before, but then building on that in my own taste.
And that's what I was going to ask about. Was it the love for cinema came first, and then you made the videos, you know, that I've referenced, kind of funny comedy sketches, but that's sort of your, that's probably how you convince your pals to get into it, for example. I need a couple extra people. Am I going to be able to get them on board by, you know, recreating a Fellini type style of film, or do I sell it as a comedy sketch and get them on board? But it sounds like you're sort of saying you enjoyed doing the videos, and then it was like, okay, I enjoy this. I feel like effectively you realize I'm a director here, I'm writing this, I'm directing that, and I'm acting. So, you know, how do I then take this to the next level? Is that fair to say?
I would say so. I think also because, like, it's interesting the way you're putting it. It's like, because I think a lot of the time you can go for your title first. And I think I've seen a lot of that. And it's like people calling themselves writer directors or whatever. And that seems like a strange way to go about it, because then you're looking at yourself in a role. Whereas, like, I was just kind of like my friends, we used to do stuff like back in the old, like, camera phones, that like when we first got them, like cyber shots and all that, when it was like mind blowing, but you could just like record terrible quality like wee sketches and stuff. But it was just a really organic thing, and I wasn't looking at like they were actors and this is my show and I'm writing directing. It was almost like we've all got the similar sense of humor. It's like, do you think this would be funny? And it all came really naturally to them. Like, I suppose it is quite strange that, like, a big group of friends and all of them are quite comfortable on camera. Do you mean it is? Because I keep hearing people saying like my mates would have never done that.
I was going to ask you exactly that, because I think about, I mean, me and my pals, we talked about your videos, we've talked about Lemmy, other videos like that, you know, the stuff that's coming out of Scotland and wider than that. But if I think about, if I was ever to say, why don't we make a video? Like, I've got this idea, I think that'd be funny. Or just spending an afternoon almost to say, what could we do? Like, let's think of something. Half of them would probably walk out the door straight away. And the other half would probably be like, yeah, I don't know, maybe spend an hour on it and I'm not sure. So I was interested to find out if it was everybody in your group of friends is actually just open to that kind of stuff.
They are. I think because it was never like, we're doing a thing here. It was almost like we're just pals mucking about. Do you know what I mean? So it never became like, oh, camera's rolling. And I think because I was starting, it wasn't like I was this established guy and I was like, do you want to be in this piece of mine? Yeah. It was like, I'm just messing about and they're probably just doing me a ton as well, like just like hungover at the weekend, like, you're still getting up for me. And, but they were, I think because, especially humour, I think that's getting more of a currency, whereas if I was making like drama shorts, I'm maybe getting some clout, like in a kind of select like group of cinephiles or whatever, like in the Glasgow area, maybe not have the same impact. But I think because laugh, and if you write funny lines for them, I mean, I can't speak for them, but that's the impression I get, that if you make them, because they're often naturally funny, but if you give them funny stuff and memorable characters and people then come up to them, it's like then they're getting something off the back of that, because yeah, they're also really funny themselves. But I do think comedy was a kind of special kettle of fish for that kind of, that style of getting your friends together.
Yeah, it's interesting that you actively mentioned that, because it was something I'd written down to ask about. It seemed just like a perfect storm of people actually coming together and there not being as many barriers, without knowing that you could easily have said, yeah, half my pals weren't interested, and it was just the ones you see on in the videos and stuff like that. And you mentioned, so you were making videos, you were thinking about like directing, or am I an actor, am I a director, what is it I'm doing, I'm writing things. And then you sort of graduate to the kind of, you're referencing or you're talking about things like Fellini, Jean-Pierre, Melville, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So was that, you've said, did you actively say, if I think I could be a director, or that interests me, you actually went out and just said, like, I'm going to go through their back catalogue to learn about that, almost to be like a student of that kind of filmmaking. Was that something you actively done?
I think so. I think, because I'm trying to remember. Like, I think I remember just being like, I want to get better at this. So who are the best? Do you mean like study who's the best? I don't know, just to copy them, but to figure out like what trying to find out what's great. Like, whose films do you love that you just know anyway from like your early influences? Who influenced them? Who did they talk about in interviews? Who did they talk about in their books and DVD commentaries? Then like who's like established and who made this a trend? And then also, I don't know. I think it is just a case of when you get a great film and you get something that sort of really like changes your world, like seeing you get something you're like, that blew my mind, you're sort of chasing that again. Like, I want the next film that's going to do that. So I'm kind of watching every film hoping it's going to be my new favourite. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm quite a good audience member. I'm not looking to shit in any films, and I kind of want to go and say, this will be amazing. Like, I don't know what your opinion is, but I kept hearing like about Godard, right, and how amazing he was and like how much he was like this and that, and I've yet to like, Band of Pars probably the only film I enjoy, but I really really struggle watching his films.
I think it's interesting whether it's that or it's that wider kind of, you go into something and you hear so much about that director or that film specifically, and it is hard to sometimes make the same connection, and sometimes you think, is it me? Is it that I don't understand film? Is it that I don't understand what's came together to pull this, you know, to make this film? I can't think of examples off the top of my head necessarily, but sometimes, I suppose actually a director that I really like is Paul Thomas Anderson, but some of his films I still don't really like. Like Magnolia is the biggest example that people seem to hold that up as his best film. For me, I just think it was way too long. And the frog stuff is ridiculous. Like, and I know that it symbolises a certain thing, but it also just feels like you're putting that in for the sake of it. Like, you've maybe heard about this frog thing, the kind of religious connotations of that or whatever it is, and it's just been thrown in there as a kind of convenient ending for the film, or a convenient way to sort of push all these stories together and say, like, things just happen at random and it's unexplained. You know, that would be one that just comes to my head about, why does everybody think this is so good compared to some of the other films that they have made, for example, as well? You know, like There Will Be Blood or whatever it happens to be is just like pure like crazy cinema that you've not seen stuff on that scale sometimes, and you've got something that people hold up in a different way. But I think it comes down to its personal opinion, you know, as you say, like loads of people can like Band Apart or that wider catalogue, but if it's not what does it for you, then you get your influences from elsewhere, you know.
And I think there's a certain maturity to that, because I think there must be a pressure when you're starting to get into films and starting to, because it's quite intimidating when there's so many films and so many films could get referenced in an interview with someone. You're like, I don't know 5% of these, and you're like, I'm an idiot, I need to see more. And that's probably part of the pressure as well. I think a lot of time it's just to be so you're in the loop in a lot of ways, because it's not to say that every one of these films is going to change your life, do you know what I mean? But it's almost just to have a frame of reference. And I think as a filmmaker, that's, I think you really do need to like treat it like training and be like watching films regularly and really kind of getting that time in, because it does help you. But I don't know. I think it's also like with Godard and stuff like that, it's like the frame of reference, like they're probably seeing like old classical films, and it's like old French cinema. They talk about that. They talk about how it was made a certain way. He broke it apart, and that was so radical at the time. But it's quite hard to reverse engineer that for yourself and see it from their point of view, because we've seen what he's then influenced, but they've mixed it with a sort of more current way, like Tarantino and all these guys that have sort of taken the jump cuts, guys that we love. But then it's hard to look at that and see it for, at the time, that was like someone set off a nuke in cinema. Do you know what I mean? It must have been so exciting.
Totally agree. I mean, yeah, I think that's a great point. And cinema is one way, is one sort of art form that does that. And I feel like a really common example that's not cinema is like people say stuff like, I hate the Beatles. And it's like, I get that now, 2022, but the amount of music, the amount of recording techniques, studio techniques that they've influenced since 1969, 70, since they stopped recording music, like if they didn't exist, and that, and I think it's wrong, whether it's cinema or music, to put everything down to one specific person, but you're right, you have to almost take it from the point where that was released. What was the landscape that they were operating in? What was the, as you say, like the references that they could use? The catalogue of films was a lot smaller, you know, just as time passes, more gets released and you can draw your inspiration and more. And as you say, like we would look at like a Tarantino film and say, yeah, okay, he's the master. Like people who have maybe not explored cinema from before the 90s or whatever, but you have to think about things like with the context of everything that's been released before, which is very difficult to do. And again, the acting thing, so I remember as well you had that appearance in Burniston, the boss's son. So was it like something that you were going down, you were acting in the film and your videos, the Burniston thing, was it like, did you ever consider, I just want to, you know, go into that process of, and I don't know how much it exists in the UK about audition. It's the kind of thing you hear from like on a podcast with like an American actor. Sure. They move to LA, auditions, they go through all of that kind of constantly. Is that something you consider doing in terms of like in a UK setting? Or?
No, I don't think so. And I don't know if that's part of the decision. I don't know if that's why directing was more appealing, because there's more that I could do. I could watch more films. I could write. I could get better in between. But if you're not getting jobs, how do you improve as an actor? That's really difficult and really scary. I did a couple auditions. I did an audition for Burniston. What happened was I was doing work experience with the BBC just as a runner, and it so happened that it was on Video Guiding, which is Robert Florence's game review show. And I just met him through that. Someone had tweeted him saying the guy who's like been a runner on there, there's got sketches, and he saw them. And then like later on, he just, the comedy unit just said, we've got you a part in here, or a couple of parts. And that was it. So it wasn't really like I was attempting to be an actor, because I was actually, that was, I think October 2016, so I was already writing, I'd already made a short of Angry Young Men, I was already writing the feature, so I'd sort of set off on my journey. The only time I sort of was thinking that was there was like an extras thing, and there's always that thing, was like, you never know what could happen, you know, you never know that you could meet someone, this could happen. But I kind of, the analogy I use is it's like getting a job in the canteen of Old Trafford with hopes of making your way into the first team eventually. Do you know what I mean? It sounds brutal, but it's almost that way where like you're not in that world, and it's not like an apprenticeship when you go on these sets. But I tried to do that, and it was like this show called like Scrotal Recall or something, right? But I just thought, right, go on a set and you never know, and it was like shooting in Hamden or something. So I went on, man, and I'm like, it sounds really poncy, but I'm sitting in a bus with extras and stuff like that, and all youngsters, and it was all great and good atmosphere and stuff. But I was just sitting myself and I was like reading like just like a Truffaut letters book, which is letters that he'd wrote, like not to give any vibe off, it's just that's what I was reading at the time. And I was just sitting there, and then they like brought us in, it's like, okay, here you go. And it's at the costume department, they gave me like this stag do or like hen do like horns and a devil's cape, and says, right, you're just dancing in this scene. and I just went like that. I've had a family emergency, and I just left. And I just fled, man. And I was like, I'm not doing this. So I think the acting stuff, I never really... I auditioned for the conservatoire when I was still doing the writing course, when I thought that's where you should be going, or like that's if you want to be an actor, try that. But see, even when I got knocked back from that, I studied not really hard for it, and like I done a lot of research and prepared very well for it, but I never felt bad. I thought my first thought was like, okay, just get a camera now, which is strange because I never thought I'm going to be a director, but that was my next step. Yeah. So it kind of all worked out for the best.
It kind of ties in the way you've positioned that is almost like it's doing it on your own terms, and everything before that, it's either material that you really can't connect with, or yeah, just potentially that kind of the conservatoire not working out, and then just you're almost like unfazed to just be, yeah, okay, I'm going to go and try and do this myself. And probably the fact that you can do it on your own terms, if you've made a short and things like that, you're like, I can see that kind of journey of, okay, I've made videos, decent response on things like social media. It sounds like, which is something I wasn't aware of, it opened a door to get onto Burniston. Just clearly someone with that platform of, yeah, you know, Robert Florence, fairly well known Scottish kind of comedy guy, and it's okay, so he likes what I'm doing, that's got opened that door, I can continue to do things on my own terms. Those little things that just sort of tick the box, it says, you know, yeah, I can actually do this and move forward like with what you want to do.
It's funny, but you don't know that at the time. Like, it makes so much sense looking back, like of course those were the decisions that you made, and of course you shouldn't have been doing that, but I don't regret any of it. Like, even I tried like a stand-up set, and it was like a disaster from the start. Like, it was in a student Queen Margaret's Union, is that Glasgow Union? Yeah. And that started off, and they weren't going to let me in because I wasn't a student, but even though they'd agreed to let me on and do like a stand-up set, it was in like a music hall, and like somebody, it wasn't even like a stand-up night, it was just a lassie was jamming before me, people were just standing, but it was pure loud, it was a nightmare for the start. But like, again, I prepared really hard for it. I got comedian like pals and that, I was checking with them, and I was writing comedy, so it sort of made sense again, do you know what I mean? You still try to figure it out, but it was a disaster. But same again, I didn't walk off and go, that's my dreams crushed. And then that was a sort of telltale sign. It's like, it can't have mattered that much, do you know what I mean? It was just like, okay, that's another avenue. But the difference is, with this, like, I've never been as stressed about something in terms of like really, really desperate for it to succeed, and not in the same way, because I mean, an independent film getting a festival, surely if it was like something else, if it was like a monetary thing, or it was like a fame thing, you'd be more invested in the comedian side. Do you know what I mean? Like, surely I would have been more, that was a sort of telltale sign. I was more concerned about this. And like, I don't know what I would have done if the Glasgow Film Festival had knocked it back, because I thought like, this is me putting everything into it, and more so than anything else I'd done before. This is like a combination of all the stuff I've tried and all the stuff I really love and care about. And I did feel it was sincere. I didn't feel it was just to get like a bit of attention or to get potentially earn money or anything like that. But again, that's when I thought, right, this is real, this one. Do you know what I mean? It's almost like, not to get too heavy, but like a relationship. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, if they were to kind of say, right, that's it sorted, and you don't, or that's as finished, and you don't feel anything, and then you kind of know that, okay, I never really did. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's what I felt with the other pursuits, whereas with this, it was a really kind of like deep in love with it and really passionate about it.
Yeah. I was going to ask that. One of the things I was going to come on to was the plan always Glasgow Film Festival, submit, and that was what you were aiming towards, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't have any other ones in mind. And I think, I mean, you know yourself, when you, like that's our place if as a film lover, and if you're Glasgow, or you're like one of the kind of satellite towns or whatever, and that's where you go to watch these art house films. These are where you go, the people that know film, they speak in our accent. So I thought, if they, and they say like the champion, I say in the interviews, and it was like Alison and Alan were like, you know, we want to champion like independent Scottish films. And I thought, right, well, if I do this, and it kind of, I can pull it off, surely they'll select it, because if it's done to a certain level, but then you're always questioned, but it's, there's no money. And again, I'm looking at previous films like Isle of Dogs, Grand Budapest Hotel, and I'm like, but they were in the festival, and you're sort of going like that, but I mean, are they going to see it's not on a very expensive camera? But then I was like, but if I can really, if it's not the most expensive lighting and all the rest of it, but if I kind of show my handwriting with how I use the camera, do you know what I mean? Yeah. If I kind of maximize that, all the things that aren't based financially, that are based on like skill and understanding of filmmaking, if I can show that and make it feel grand but also kind of tight on a very like small scale, then surely that'll be like a good introduction. And then luckily it was.
Yeah. And I think you absolutely nailed that. Like, as we've discussed, I watched it last night, and we'll get on to the film itself. True. But yeah, I think that's exactly it. Like, and even stuff that you've mentioned, or less expensive camera. I mean, I've been watching films from the festival since the kind of industry platform kicked off and the film kicked off, and it doesn't have that. You know, if I put it side by side with other things, I don't think it doesn't stand up against it. You know, genuinely, I don't think that.
It's hard, but because even like certain films, that there might be ones that are, they could have like thousands and thousands in DP and lighting rigs and stuff, but see if it's shot all like, goes back to, you might have the money but you don't really like know why you're picking shots, so see if you have like a static and then like there's no like storytelling with the camera, and it's, you've got a lot of money behind it, it doesn't matter. Do you mean it really doesn't, I don't think.
Totally. And the use of the camera, again, got notes on it to talk about, but yeah, just that is like, it's a character itself in the film where you're watching it, and again, seen other films, and if it is just, you know, static camera positioned in a certain place compared to the stuff that you're doing and pulling off, like it is a level above films that I've seen. That, again, there are, I mean, a lot of the films in the festival are also films that you can tell aren't, you know, like big budget films, sure, but they've got backing budget in different ways, definitely got, you know, a much bigger crew, etc. So yeah, for sure, there's nothing, I don't think, from your film that says like, if that's got to be the one that is sort of made by one guy, you know, doing it and kind of plan it over a number of years. Like, there's a lot, especially with the camera work, like I say, that really does stand up and exceeds a lot of the other films that are there, for sure.
Absolutely.
So yeah, was there a particular moment then? So you've talked about things, stand-up set didn't go well, you've done some acting, you've made some sketches with your pals and other videos, you've made a short for Angry Young Men, so was there a particular moment where you decided like, I am going to now focus on writing a feature film, and it's going to be Angry Young Men, which I've made a short for? Was there a moment, or was that the plan?
Do you know, I'd always thought about festivals, even when I was making shorts, because you'd like read like what do you do and all that, what's a short, what do you do with your short films, and it was like festivals and this and that, how do you become a filmmaker? So even before I'd really decided, I thought festivals. But again, looking back, when things start to make sense, I didn't really acknowledge at the time, and I didn't really think, feel like excuse me, something like that. But like 2016, I'd been writing it, and I was thinking, I was pretty serious. But like 2017, like my dad died in like February, and I never felt like this one's for you. Do you know what I mean? Like a stupid thing, but it almost felt like a sort of, right, if you're going to do it, like you need to get started, get moving. So I think that's when things kicked up a gear and the writing get more serious, and I started like really getting the head down. And like I said, consciously, I would say no, it didn't have an impact on me. But when I look back, it can't be a coincidence that's when things turned up a gear somewhere. Like deep down, I was like you've not got like time's running out in that sort of way. Do you know what I mean? So I thought that's where you have to kind of kick up. So I would say around about 2017 is where I really did start taking it serious.
Yeah, makes sense. You know, it strikes a chord. Like if you suffer a loss, then you get that different sense of time and mortality and whatever else. You know, you just realize like, I could sit here and not do something that I want to do, rather than let me just do it, like get my head down, as
definitely
you say. So yeah, I mean, I'm on to the film, and I think I'm right in saying it took 1 year to write and 3 years to film. Just my take on what it's about, if you like, is a fictional area of Mauchton governed by like a hierarchy of gangs or groups, sort of with the gang that you lead. I think, yeah, you'd call you the leader for of the gang, yeah. So they're sort of at the top of the hierarchy, and the Campbell gang arrive in Mauchton, kind of trying to shake things up a bit, and it's about the struggle, the power struggle between the two groups, and then the sort of secondary groups that are in the area as well.
So when you're
writing it, are you writing it based on what you think is possible with like a small kind of, the way you made it, you know, almost like potentially at times a one-man crew or sort of micro budget, as the Glasgow Film Festival described it? Were you writing it with that in mind, in terms of what can I actually do? I've got a camera, I might be able to get lights, you know, hopefully I know someone who can try and do some music, that kind of thing. Or are you writing it as in, because you hear when you listen to interviews with directors or people who are specifically screenwriters, they just write scripts. Maybe one will get picked up. If it doesn't, I'll move on to the next one. Did you write the film with, I'm going to make this? Or did you write it as, you know, I can maybe send it to someone and maybe they'll pick up and hopefully I could direct? Do you know what I mean?
No, it was always, I knew I was writing to make. And that's the only way I could be motivated to write it, really, was to know this is going to be an outcome. I couldn't, that was another like way in college where I knew that I wasn't a writer, because they would talk about, you know, and sometimes you'll have five scripts sitting on the shelf, and I was like, I couldn't write five. I couldn't care about that many things. Mm-hmm. You mean, if I'm in it, I'm all in, and I had to be all in knowing what I could make. But I never really thought, oh, this would be great, but we've got no money. So I was always quite excited about what I was writing, because I always kind of knew the possibility. I was like, well, I know I've got, from my sketches and my good friends, I've got like a core cast of about 10. So I could have that like mini ensemble. But then I know, like, if I put this out here, surely I'll get local actors. Like, surely I'll get, if I write good parts for them and they like the script, then surely I will. Maybe I could get some crew. I knew that I'd been working with the camera, like doing like wee corporate gigs and like making shorts. I could operate every bit of equipment, the drone, the gimbal, cranes. I could do all that. So I knew like I could make this feel grand, and I knew the locations. Like, I'd spent a lot of time just walking about the area, with my Steadicam and going up the woods and going through the scheme and like just looking at different things, saying like, this could be a real backdrop for a big, big story, like without having to put any money in. So I was always writing for that. And then I thought, imagine you could be out in the streets in the morning and have like a gang of like so many there. I mean, that is possible. Do you mean, there's the only thing, that's not a financial choice. So I was like, I was quite excited about that, but I was never like, I never thought I'll need to pitch this and get money, because that would change like everything about the film. Do you know what I mean? Like, that would totally like change what you're writing for.
Yeah. And one of the things that I'd noted down actually before watching it was, did you have to compromise when you got to the point of like, I've got a script, but now I'm actually trying to take what's on the page and put it into practice? But I think having seen it, like, there doesn't appear to be any of that because of what you've been able to do, like whether that's drone footage from, you know, shots from above characters as they move through like the scheme or the area, the scale of it with the amount of characters and stuff like that, it doesn't feel like there's any compromise. But is there anything that you can think of? It doesn't sound, the way you've spoke about it, that you've seen everything as a challenge rather than I'll need to take that out because I don't think I could do it.
The only thing I said that, I was doing like a youth panel yesterday about like youngsters and first features, and it was one of the things I would have done if I had money. The only thing I would have done was I would have took all the cars that aren't the like antagonist car off the road, because I wanted to make it like feel not like a period piece, but almost like take all the modernity out of it. Like, there's no mobiles, like even the landlines. I was like, should I get a cord phone in? But then I was like, but it's sort of, because it's surreal, I'm not placing it in a time, but I just wanted to take all that out of it, and I wanted the town to feel just like this like western town, almost like tumbleweed place. And then this car comes in and it's the only one about. But because it's not like we were shooting and there was traffic and people there, so we did get that feeling that it was an empty place. That's the only thing I would change. But again, I think it's like intention. If I'd started out thinking, right, I could maybe get some money, and I opened up with like this well-lit like studio shot, and then we went to a different model and started doing it, then you'd be like, this is inconsistent. But I think because the intentions were always to make the most of what we had.
And you say like not a period piece, but it would make it timeless almost. I think that sounds like what you'd be aiming for, because it takes, there's maybe the cars that the Campbell group are using or something like that, but yeah, if you take out everything else, then it is just like, it frames the area you've shot it in at a particular point in time, but hopefully without that, as you say, like not some of the things that would tell you it's like made in 2022 versus some other time.
Definitely.
And I've seen like social media and stuff like that, posts about things like the police being phoned and the kind of challenges that you would face, which you could, on one hand, you think it's crazy that someone would phone the police for that kind of thing, but then you see the film and there's people running about in balaclavas and stuff like that. So maybe, you know, some housewife looking out the window is kind of worried and thinks, I may have to let the coppers know. But was there challenges like that? I mean, aside from that, or if there's anything to do with the police turning up, like how did they handle that situation? Or
they were okay. Most of the time they would sort of come up and they'd smile. The only one time it was bad was, I learned, I don't know if anyone that's like wanting to be a filmmaker, I only learned this a few times in. A sound guy told me this, that before you're going to film anything, that you have to email the police. It's just a generic email, and you say, here we are, give them as much detail as possible, here's my contact number. So I'd done that later on, and this is one of the occasions I'd had already done it, but it's one of the scenes, it's like an early chase scene, and it's like the white Campbell guys in the masks are in a black car driving by, and we had to do retakes. So I'm like 100 to 200 yards away on my mobile, try to cue them in to like reset and come back in with the car. But the police had came by and blocked them in, and then I ran down and I was like, I've got like audio of it, because I didn't realize I hadn't stopped recording. I'm sprinting down and I'm like, I've emailed, like we're filming and all that, and then they were like, all units stand down, good intent or something like that. And I was like, geez, Owen, I sent them the email and they were like really nice about it and they were saying like, no, it's okay, and like it's a fault at our end because like the shop owner had phoned the police because they saw them going by like two or three times, which is understandable again, but it wasn't my fault. But the one thing I was worried about is because we filmed, even like some of the old short films we did was all on locations, like stuff in Fair Hill. And I was just worried that, see if someone had came out their house or we'd been shooting somewhere and they just decided to stand in the background, there's nothing I can do because I've got no right, they live there, and if they want to say, what are you going to do? It's not your land. No. I was worried about that.
And I was thinking that about just, as you know, in any sort of scheme area, whatever you get, wee bams or whatever, who are just not going to move, and when you ask them to, they find it funny, and if they don't, so was there not really any of that? They kind of respected, I mean, I don't know if they were passing by or whatever, but
no, a handful of times, like what, there was a few like older people that they were kind of would come out and just put their hands in their hips and the boys would have to drive on, like they were only sitting there to reset for the shot, but then the youngsters were like really, really nice, and like young guys and that were shouting down for the flats when we're filming, like what you're filming, like all the best and that, and asking about the page. See, most people are really, really supportive about it and think it's cool, which is like the opposite. You think they'll see you and mock you for like, oh, like prancing about and all that, but they were really, really nice. The only time we were shooting was down by the tunnels and we heard like these big boulders getting tossed, and it was this wee, it turned out to be like these wee like 5 and 6 year olds, but then when we walked back, we'd finished filming, they were tossing these boulders down and all that throughout the filming, then when we finished, went back up and they came up and they were like pure white like Disney characters, like, what are you filming? And they're pure nice, and I was like, what is this, man? Like, so they're just bored, I think. But most of the time they were really, really nice.
Nice one. I'd see in terms of like other challenges, I mean, 3 years shooting schedule with largely amateur actors, volunteers and that sort of stuff. So how did it go with like commitment, you know, hangovers, that kind of stuff? Just people might say, yeah, I'll do it, and they're your pals, but even that kind of thing, did you have that kind of challenge?
I was really worried about it because it was a huge commitment. Like Miller, like he had another wee boy, Blair. Connor had a wee boy, Otis, so during it, and like they were having full lives going on. They were working like at the hour. Do you mean they've got partners, they're having nights out, they've got football on. Do you mean like it's early mornings, like a lot of time freezing cold, and for what? They didn't know there was going to be like a premiere, they didn't know it was going to amount to anything. It could have been Sunny Fire on YouTube and nobody watches, and that's the reality, and that was the fear of it. Like it could be nothing, and you have to accept that going in. Like you can't be crying if it does, that's the way it goes, because it's a possibility. So it was really, I did really struggle in terms of, not because they were being like, oh, I'm not doing this and I won't be out, it was almost like I was very aware of the balance. Like I wasn't being a great friend, I wasn't able to see them as much as a friend. I mean, I was more just like saying, can you do this date, can you do that date, and they're probably just doing like, for what? Do you know what I mean? And I wasn't doing like nights out and stuff, so there was times like that where I felt like I'm kind of taking liberties here, but we did get through it, and I tried to work around it by having certain days like, I only need you here and you only need to be here for an hour, and I tried to get better at scheduling them, but that was sort of the main challenge, I would say.
It's funny that like you maybe compare it to like a professional set where if time goes on, you're burning through money, but almost for you it's like you're burning through that kind of currency you've built up with your pals, you know.
Definitely.
I don't want to waste your time, so yeah, I suppose that almost like you're having to project manage all of that. As a director would any time, just make sure that time's well spent, but just, you know, you're doing it where you know everybody's doing it almost like out of good faith and a passion and a faith in what you're doing. So
I think it's a great lesson, but because even though you could say like, oh, money, that's more serious and stuff, but it depends how highly you value it. Like, because my mates, like I'm sure that yourself, it's like your friend group is like everyone, and if you kind of like fall back and if things aren't right there, then it puts your head everywhere. Do you know what I mean? So you need to keep that. So I would treat that more serious than like if I had a bit of money and it was coming out of my pocket. Do you know what I mean? Like, so I think it's a great lesson about what you actually need and what you want, and then what you can do. And like, because everyone thinks like, oh, it's the money men, and like, oh, they ruin everything, and producers, and it's like, but you need to be prepared. You need to actually know your stuff inside out. You can't just turn up on the day and think, oh, I'm an artist, let me just like, drift off for a minute.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? As much as that can be romantic, it's like, it teaches you to get your plan in place, which is a good thing.
Yeah. Something else that I noticed and was that you almost could, the fact that it was shot over 3 years gave you something that you might not have got if you had like a 40-day shooting schedule. Definitely. Which was the snow that that came, just stuff like that. I mean, I don't know if there was anything else, but just that fact of it's now snowy because we've went through 3 years here, and I can go out and I can shoot some stuff, some either just sort of you know, setting the scene in the snow, because I remember at the time in the film, it's not like there's loads of characters, it's not like a scene with that dialogue, I don't think, but it just shows the passing of time that you've got the benefit of, because time is actually passing. Was there anything else that, even though it might sound on paper like, you know, a director's nightmare, or someone who's making a film, like, I have to shoot this part-time across, you know, while I'm juggling jobs and everything else that everybody else is doing, but was there anything else that it gave you, actually, like, you seen the positive from, that you might not be able to have done if you shot it in a couple of months?
I think so. I think that was one thing that I'd written for, because I thought at the very minimum it's going to be a year, and I thought I want, because I'd obviously that scene was in it from the start, that the kind of going to the mattresses sort of montage, but that was like one thing I thought, if we have that, that's another sort of free production value you can add, because you've been out here and you've got this like beautiful setting, and I know I can take the drone up and I can do that. There's something I could do myself without getting a crew together. But I think a kind of benefit for the production was that by the time, like, I didn't do the fight scenes first. Like, we did, I think the first scene we shot was in the kitchen, the breakfast scene. But then, as I think we had more stuff to show, and I thought I used to post clips of stuff, like, oh, a good day shooting and all the rest of it. But I think as I could show more, then people were sort of legitimized it. So then when it came time, okay, now we're going to do this fight scene, who wants to come? Then we had, because it'd been over so long and I had quite a bit to show people, like, what we're doing, we were absolutely amateur, but we were like, had a bit of skill about it, then more people were interested. So I think having that prolonged time period kind of allowed us to build some hype.
Yeah, that makes sense. For sure I had something else to add. You said, like, you thought it would take at least a year, so it wasn't, I suppose it'd be difficult to plan something like, it's going to take me 3 years. So was that, you thought it might be about a year and it just continued to, time just kept getting away from you and racking up? Yeah,
it did. I think it's because I'd written, my model was Christopher Nolan's Following. But obviously it makes sense. I didn't realise at the time, but I'd written myself in a corner that it was such a big ensemble piece, because it was like a core cast of 10. And then I think obviously as we got older, how we made the shorts, I could say, got you free. Most people were, they were at uni or something, they were just like, the only thing they had was like a night out. But then it was like, oh no, these people are now in jobs, they've now got partners, they've got kids. And then I started realizing you can't, you know, get everybody's weekend, and trying to like orchestrate so many, so the time in between, that was quite demoralizing, because I was like, so I'm not gonna make progress with this film until next month, and it could get cancelled the week before. The one person we need to be there on the day isn't there, and I can't shoot how I want, and I'm not going to shoot them in a close-up 3 weeks from now. Do you mean I don't want to shoot with that? I want everyone to be there, because I did have a certain style in mind, this kind of all-encompassing, show the geography and, like, you know, show everyone and try and make it as grand as possible. So I knew I didn't want to shoot with that, but that was probably the most kind of demoralising part about it.
Yeah, and I think you definitely achieved that. Again, like, we were talking just before about the outfit that opened Glasgow Film Festival, like, made in a... basically one set, one place, compared to what you've done. You know, I've seen a lot of that area, you know, I've never been there, but I've seen the woods, I've seen the scheme, I've seen the open fields, you know. It is on a grand scale that you would maybe think, if you were to sort of set the scene for someone about, like, the limitations of what you had to make the film, think that sort of thing, you know, it would be like, you would never expect, I think, to see as much as what that was, what your film does, for sure.
Thank you, man.
No problem. So I think as well, a big thing with a lot of filmmakers, you mentioned it, is the way that they reference their inspirations with shots or character names or using the same music, same motifs, whatever. You know, there's so many kind of examples of that. Is that something that you look to do? Like, is there things in there? Like, I sort of noted down a few that I thought that could be that, but then at the same time, it could easily not have been. So, what did you think? Well, I thought the Irish shots were very like Scorsese, you know, like Departed, when it focuses on Sullivan twice, I think it happens, and he uses that throughout. So, I immediately thought, that is that a Departed reference or a Scorsese in general reference?
Not consciously, but it must be, because spoiler alert maybe, but The Departed, like, funnily, like, it wasn't in my, I don't think it was in my mind, it's hard to tell now, but see in terms of plot, in terms of, again, spoiler, but the sort of return of a character, and the sort of same sense as Wahlberg, that must be the model that was like, because that is one of my favourite films, and I've seen people saying it's like Scorsese light, which I think is bullshit. I think it's a phenomenal film. I think it's one of the best. It must have been. And you know, I don't really. I do kind of like recoil a wee bit from like the homaging and doing certain shots. I never thought, oh, that's sort of like wee moment. And I think about part of it was just like the influence of my friends, because like a couple, they're not like all foreign film buffs or anything like that, but they can kind of sense like that's bullshit and like why are you doing like stupid stuff like that? You try to do that and it's like just try and be your, and that's a great thing for me, and it's almost like just do what you like. But I never really wanted to sort of do like, oh, that's a shot, and then because all you get out of that is, have you seen that? Where's the like invention in that? Do you mean where's the invention in just copying or like regurgitating? That's like somebody, the Good Will Hunting scene, and like he's regurgitating a book he's read. Is like there's no independent thought there. So I feel the same way with your shots. But in terms of influences, you know, like tonally, I felt like Army of Shadows and Ivan's Childhood were like two big ones. And again, it was for the ending, because there's this sort of like feeling where it's not a happy ending, but there's like a kind of a deep power with it. It's almost like this sort of like fate. Do you know what I mean? It was almost like there was nothing the characters could have ever done. And that sort of like futility, that's what I was sort of influenced by. But with at the same time, making it exciting, making it like grand, and like how you use the camera. So they were the influences. And then maybe just been out in location and using like scale and all that, probably Lord of the Rings, but they're not things that I would have been like, how was that shot? It was just more like they're in the bloodstream, do you know what I mean?
I was taking notes when I was watching the film last night, and I wrote down Lord of the Rings as well, for just like I mean, this happens in a lot of like big battle scenes, but like the way the camera pans across like the front line of the like one of the armies or the gang or whatever, and then even the shot of them sort of like charging towards each other, like, it's definitely very Lord of the Rings. Like, I wrote that down. What else did I? Yeah, and I think you're right in terms of the like the theme, the tonality. It is like it's almost like the characters or the landscape of Mauchton. It's like they're in like a cycle, and it's like. That is, as you say with the ending, that is just the cycle they're stuck in. It's referenced throughout, like, that's the way it is, this is the hierarchy, either people trying to break free from that or people trying to maintain that, and it's like that is sort of cyclical of the place, you know. I think that really comes through for sure, because it is referenced. It's not, you said like spoiler ending, maybe just the ending, but it's kind of, once you see the entire film, it's referenced, I think, the whole time.
I think we tried to do that from like the opening line. Like the opening line's, I'm not going anywhere, and it's meant a different way. It's meant like a defiant way, where it's like, I'm not moving, but it's almost like that, you might become like my master to it, but then as time sets in, then you get caught up in the rhythm of the place, and it's hard to get away from that, because with the best intentions, you do just sort of get caught up in where you are. It's just your environment.
Yeah, I mean, the other reference I noted in, although I had to actually go back and watch the scene, I thought the breakfast scene, which I really enjoyed, when Don, is it, he's like writing in the notepad, and I thought, that's what Harvey Keitel does at the start of Reservoir Dogs, and they're eating breakfast.
Oh, does it? But that's funny.
But he actually, I went and watched it back, so I was like, that's a great reference, but he steals a notepad off Joe, like the kind of guy who's like running the heist, and he's the one sort of sitting messing about with his notepad, and I thought, I wonder if that's intentional. But because Keitel isn't actually doing that the entire scene, I thought, I've almost like made up that reference myself. But it's funny, there's a notepad in there, and there's a breakfast getting eaten, so yeah.
Maybe it is. I'll take it, not consciously. Yeah. But it was good, man.
Yeah, and then the other one, which was back to the one of the sketches you've done, is when Charlie's on the phone and he's kind of like, he's not moaning, but it's the same as when Stan was on the phone to his mum about everyone wearing tank tops. So I was like, I wonder if that was intentional, or you just like someone with their back to the camera upstairs in front of a window on the phone.
Oh, a self-homage, man.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I thought, like, who knows, these things happen. That is impressive if you'd consciously done that. So I'll give you that one if it wasn't.
I'll take it.
Aye. And then the other one I just felt like was lifted. Like, and I think it's funny that you're plucking these things. Like, is it Scorsese? You're referencing some of the absolute like legend, heavyweight, classic filmmakers in terms of just things that, you know, you've watched and thought about, your own sketches. And even at the very beginning, there's the, where did you get that? And he's got like the extendable Kosh thing. Kosh, and it's like Anchorman, like, where'd you get a hand grenade? I just felt like it was like,
maybe that is
something just coming from every angle. So I think that like the best films are ones that work in different levels. Like, it's funny, but it's really serious. Like things like someone like Scorsese or whatever can do that kind of thing. Like, it's got amazing music, like, it's uplifting, but it's really grim storytelling, and that's, you know, that kind of thing. I think your film has that, because there was a lot of laugh out loud moments for me, the sort of surrealist nature of it, but then at the same time, it's, you know, it's like a gritty kind of portrayal of, well, it's a sort of, I don't know if dystopian's the right word, but it's like, it is a surreal kind of environment. People don't run about in balaclavas and sort of have costumes that associate them with different groups, you know, like a sort of way of dressing. It still has that sort of, it has that gritty, very sort of serious nature along with, like, yeah, I was laughing throughout, so.
Well, thank, well, that's, it's a hard one because, see, because I was coming off the back of doing, like, kind of like heavy satire and stuff like that, I felt there was a real danger when I was starting to write, excuse me, where it's like, if you are too ironic or too satirical, you're going to like protect yourself in a certain way where it's like, you're almost writing like shaking, like, are people going to think this is silly? And it's like, but if I slag myself first or I slag the premise first, then I'm safe, I've protected myself, but you undermine like the full premise and you almost like take away any possible heart or like, just putting yourself out there, and it's like, just if it is, just like allow it to be what it is, rather than everything's like a wee nod to camera, like, oh, I get this, don't worry. And to me, that's the kind of the first hurdle I had with like writing was like, try and be like, sincerity was a big thing for me, like not to be like, oh, bleeding my heart and saying here's what I feel and not have any humor, but like trying to get the sort of tonal way where it was like, yeah, life is like funny and there are moments that are like heavy absurd, but then also trying to keep it, I wanted it to be like a really full story, and that's great that you've kind of picked up on that.
No, I agree, because I think that's a great point. Like, again, we've talked about it in the past about like trying to get people on board, and you said, you know, comedy's easier to do it that way. But I think when it is a feature film, if you were doing too much of that, like, yeah, okay, we know it's like gangs, but there's costumes, but don't take it too seriously. Mm-hmm. But like, it fully commits to that whilst having individual funny moments, the way that, you know, if in real life there was anything serious happening, whether it is like gang warfare or whatever, like there's going to be people in there wisecracking, saying stupid stuff that when, if you were to be a fly in the wall, it would be funny. So that's what it captures, rather than, oh yeah, this is, let's make it funny because maybe people will, at least easier, it's like an easier in for people. Mm-hmm. You know, so.
And I think on the flip side of that, say for example you set out, like there was I don't know if you watched it or not, but there was like a Scottish TV show called The Cruise. Do you remember this? No,
I don't think so.
It was fairly recent, or I say it was like maybe it was longer than that, but it was a while ago. And like no disrespect to anyone that was involved or anything, but it was all, people were pitching it as like the Scottish Sopranos. But you could almost feel the intention was, let's make this really gritty. But then if you know anything about the Sopranos, then you know that it's so close to a sitcom that it's unbelievable. Like, yeah, you're missing so much. And it's like, these guys don't, like, the one of the great lines is like Junior saying, hold on, we're not making a Western here. As soon as he tries to do the gangster thing, let's take them out of the game. And you always see these bad gangster films, it's like, they call me like one-eyed so-and-so and all that, and they're all like, and it's so silly. And it's almost like the more serious you are, the more silly it is. But then it's almost like, if you can involve that humor, the more serious it is, because it's closer to reality. It's like, these gangsters don't come in and like, I mean, some of them probably do, some of them are probably parodies in real life, but if you try and make the full thing is, look how gritty this is, then I think you just totally defeat the purpose. And at the same time, if you try and make it, how funny are we and how funny is this film, then you also totally undermine it, and it goes flat to me anyway.
Yeah, I think it makes it too contrived, you know. It's
exactly,
as you say, the mission statement here is gritty film or whatever, and it's, you can tell it from a mile off, unless it is just happens to come together in the best way. But that's what I think, that's almost like any film that you watch and you don't really enjoy it. There can be other reasons, like plot didn't make sense, I didn't really engage with the characters, whatever. But a lot of the time, sometimes it's like, I went to see that, or I think with the film festival as well, is that you don't have that much information going in, so you read the small plot summary or whatever and you think, that sounds good, but then sometimes the reason why you come away saying, well, that wasn't a classic for me, that wasn't great, was that it feels too contrived. Like, this is a melodrama, so everything's going to be going wrong, and it's really, it's just too unbelievable, too dramatic. Like, they're overselling whatever the message is, you know. And I think that can definitely happen, as you say. Like, if you go out with just that one theme or one kind of style that you're going to go, this is gritty, I think you could definitely get caught in the trap of making it too much, like, remember it's gritty, guys. Like, you know, if you're directing, like, remember that we can't don't do that look, don't make that quip if there's any sort of improvising on the in terms of like the script, like you can't do that.
So I think it's a fear thing as well, and I think it applies to comedy. It's like oh, this is kind of, just make a joke, because I mean obviously like the way people crack jokes a lot is a defense thing, and it's almost like I need to fill this bit of silence or I need to do that, but it's almost like they want to commit that way. But I was rewatching All About My Mother the other night, the Almodovar film.
Yeah.
And see, if you watch his films, you just go to me like, who can do it like that? Like, who can blend comedy, like absurdity, like this sort of like bright, vibrant images with real darkness, but then also with like these like outrageous characters? But who can do that? And it's almost like, it's somebody who's comfortable enough to see life for what it is and can commit like that way. But someone feels like this is a, like, I don't really see films like this as a genre film. Like, it's only when you start having to pitch a film or like somebody asks you what kind of film it is, and it helps to have these categories. But if you sit out, I know Tarantino, he's a great like subgenre guy, and that's how maybe his brain works and everything. But to me, it was like, you're kind of like, to see these rules or to see it like this is this type of film. So if you start off, or maybe you're in Hollywood and they're like, I want to write the next great, like, do you mean? So maybe you would start thinking crime, or but you would think you're missing all this other life out.
Yeah, and it's too formulaic, and it's like almost the greatest directors are great because they sort of transcend those boxes or genres or follow that formula, because that is the reason why it's called like a formula. The reason why films have that, oh, that's just the classic sort of A to B to C type of film, whatever genre it's in. Like, the reason why nobody remembers them with any great sort of, like, they don't have that lasting power to be ones that you're referencing in an interview or whatever, like, is because they don't do anything that is challenging for themselves or for the viewer or whatever. They don't sort of challenge the kind of usual parameters that films that have gone before it have actually been in. So,
yeah, for sure.
The score was another thing, again, like the camera work. I think the score just is really front and center for certain scenes. Like the scene that Raymond first encounters the Campbell gang, and then he's like, he's sort of hopping away on crutches. And I mean, when I was watching that, I was writing down things that I noticed, which was basically every time something new came into the score in that specific piece, like, I was just thinking, like, it's like, Johnny Greenwood and the Master, or like, it's like those kind of like staccato, like cello or string kind of sections, but then you've got the kind of arpeggio, more modern like synth sounds, which even, I don't know if they used synths at the time, but like the Samurai soundtrack, which has got that really kind of modern for a film made in 1967. Like, and again, obviously these are like Johnny Greenwood, Radiohead, professional musician, like, you know, one of the best composers working now and all that kind of thing. But like, I don't think that it felt as if it was a million miles away from that.
Brilliant, man.
And what I wanted to ask was, because at the end it's co-credited alongside Patrick Boland. So, and I, from your social media, it seemed like you almost at one point you took it upon yourself to like do the score. So what was the story behind that?
It's bad, but it's worked out amazingly. But I've been working with a guy, and we've done like stuff for the sketches and stuff, like just we sort of like tunes together, like that Stans ballad sketch and all, right, like, yeah. That was him.
And is that Patrick?
No, so that's right. That's not, but he's like one of my best, so it all makes, again, it makes perfect sense in hindsight. Like, Patrick's like one of my best mates, but I've been working with this guy like from like 2015. And Pat was like, he's quite like a private guy, and he works in his music in private, then he releases like these amazing tunes. Subside is his DJ name, but he's like releases this amazing music, but he's quite private and all that. So that was maybe the one reason I didn't approach him all those years ago, even though he's like, I just didn't realize like how good he was, or like I didn't realize he'd be up for it. So I've been working with this guy for ages, and then he'd been involved with the script stage and all that. They came up with wee themes and stuff like that, and they were amazing. Like, he's classically trained, like really, really talented guy. And then we'd like met, I showed him a rough cut before I had like two or three scenes. I think it was the start of 2021. I had like two or three scenes to shoot, but the bulk of it was there. Like, what you needed to know for what was big score numbers, what was there. And I was like, okay, so okay, give you some time. Like, I'll give you this rough cut away, and like, just you send me over whatever you want, because I love hearing it. It motivates me. So I was like, send me everything, send me all this. And eventually, it like months would pass, and I'd be checking in, and like nothing was happening. It was always like, oh yeah, I've got ideas with this, I've got ideas with that, and I was starting to realize that I hadn't really thought, to be honest. Like, Glasgow was going to be my main one, but I hadn't thought about festivals until I got close to the finishing, because you know how it's like, there's like a calendar for submissions and all that, so I wasn't thinking about that. I thought the film would be done when it's done, and then I'll start thinking about festivals. But then I was like, I've shot pretty much 95% of this in Glasgow. I could submit at the end of October. And I was like, well, then what's your alternative? You wait another year? And I'm like, I'm not waiting another year, because it's pretty much, I've done everything I need to do. So then I was like, it was tough. And I was like, what do you think and all that? And he's like, I just don't think it's going to be possible. And I was getting annoyed because there was nothing that had been done. Do you know what I mean? Like, and I feel bad doing that. But Higgy was really, really busy, really high flying job. He's a great parent and all that. So he was like, he had a lot going on. But I was just, I was like, right, no, I need to be selfish, but I want to submit to Glasgow Film Festival. I listened to a lot of scores, and like Stan's Ballad, I came up with, like, I wrote the lyrics to that, and sort of like came up, and I always like kind of mess about wee melodies in my head, but I'm not like trained in anything. But I was like, it's not that bizarre, me thinking if I could teach myself how to edit, and I could teach myself like Photoshop and all the rest of it, like, what's the difference? You're just saying, you know the feeling, now you just need to get the technical sides. I thought, okay, give it a try. So I downloaded Ableton, I got like a wee Akai keyboard. I started messing about with it, and I was like, I always feel this scene should feel like this, and it should have these big moments and all that, and it should have this sort of instrumentation. I love strings, I love horns. Oh, that would be great. And I wrote the intro, and I was like, and I was listening to Nicola, my wife, I was let her hear it and all that, and I was like, that works, doesn't it? Like, it might not be, it's not the tightest, but that works. So what I would do is I did a wee bit of it, and I let Pat hear it. I had like a night in mind, like, we were all steaming, and I was showing him like this rough cut, and I was like, what do you think? And he was just like that. He listened to it, and he was like, the keys are far too dry. And he was like, and I it was language I didn't understand. That he's obviously, that's when the skill comes in. And I was like that, and I says, but it's good, but in it, like, tonally, like, it goes I like, it works, like, the emotion of it works. And I was like right, okay. And then he says come to my bit at the weekend. And then I had like three or four songs, like maybe half an hour done, three or four scores to it. And he would just sit, and he would like say, right, this needs to be that. He'd fill out all the space. He would change the instrumentation. He would tighten everything up, because I was just doing it by ear, so my timing was off with a lot of them. He would do that. I would go away the next week, write like another half an hour. He would tighten everything up, make it bigger, really, really polish it up, and then again, made it a score pretty much. And we did that for the full thing. It was like 5 weeks we'd done it in. And I'm happier now. Like, that guy is like so talented. He was working on it before, but I'm so happy. It's one of my proudest things about the film now. I really love it.
Yeah, I think it comes through that way. And what you've mentioned, like the things that Patrick added to it, I mean, that's almost like the sort of artist and producer relationship that you would get in music. Like, so I wouldn't I feel like when I seen the credit, it was like the text of his name is a little bit bigger, as if you were like trying to put the credit on to him, which I'm sure he'd done a lot, you know. It's I don't mean,
could
mean
done
it in that
could
way.
Could have done it about him, honestly. It would have sounded like me at the keys. Like, right. He done a huge amount. But like, so like, I wrote it, and he like made it what it was. Really.
But again, that's like, if you, in terms of you put together the chord sequences or the motifs, that the kind of little melodies that sort of occur and reoccur, like, still should take a lot of credit for that. I do think it really worked. And I think that score is a big thing. Like, music, I'm a big fan of music just in general, and I think like films with big, great soundtracks like are often the films that I like the most, if you know what I mean. So I think, and think films that are on the film festival often don't really have musical moments or maybe scores to speak of, because they don't have the budget for it. Like, they either don't have the budget to license songs, which obviously is very expensive for what you're getting out of it, maybe a couple of minutes or whatever, but also to pay someone to create a soundtrack and write a score. But this film has it, and it, again, like the camera, it really sets it apart for the things that maybe you didn't have, whether it's professional acting or just like a big crew that can do X, Y, and Z. But you've done so much with the things that you can influence. Like, you buy an Akai keyboard, you get Ableton, and you can make music. Like, and you don't even need things like Ableton or whatever, you know, you can do things yourself. Like, as an extension of, you say, you know, you decided the acting stuff didn't really work out, you grabbed your camera, like, you then realised that I want to have music in this, probably for the same reasons that I've said about scores are just a big part of, like, the best films. So you're like, or some of the best films, and you just think, well, I need a score, so I'm going to do it. Like, so it's not worked out with the previous relationship guy, you know, that you were talking about. And you utilise some of the connection you've got with Patrick, but at the same time, like, you've taking it upon yourself, because I could imagine people might just say, yeah, like I'll just, I don't know, I'll maybe use some stock music or something. Like,
it just, that was, and I think you can, it'd be fair to say from watching the film, you can tell it's a film made for a score. It's, there's so many sections that are like dialogue free, and there's so many just like physically kind of all action scenes, do you know what I mean, and like chase scenes and stuff. And I knew, like I said, and I could feel, like I said, I could feel it. I was like, in this bit in the film, even when I'm writing, like I listen to a lot of music when I'm like writing and thinking of ideas, and I was like, oh, this is this. And I was like, oh, this should come up here, but I couldn't articulate it, and like I've not got the skill for it, do you know what I mean? But I knew I could make it like feel that way. And then it's just figuring out what makes that emotion, and it's like, oh, well, it could be strings, it could be that. So I think like that was definitely a big part of it, but it was never an option to do like kind of stock stuff. And also like, no, I'd be cynical, but, and I'm not looking at like a sort of like a brand way, but to think about, if you think about the brand of the film, or you think about what's the unifying thing, it's like if you see maybe the red, blue and yellow, that links, I can use that in other ways to sort of reference the film. It's the costume, it's the logo, it's a poster. It's like, and that score, if you've got that, I love that when you hear a bit of scoring and then you think of the scene and you go, yeah. Ah, that's that. Do you mean? So I thought, I love that. And it's because I'm passionate about it. I wanted like something was specific to the film, not just general elevator music that would maybe pass the time. It's like, ah, well, that kind of stops me from being bored. I wanted it to be like, ah, that's like, that's how that film sounds. That's how that film is. It sums up the film. And that's what we tried to do.
It definitely has that. I mean, the Raymond sequence at the beginning of the film, like, because it gets layered on top of each other and it starts to grow. And as I say, I was taking notes and like it was just every new thing that occurred in the sound and the score for that part. Like it was, you could tell it was put together with care, and it really does add to the suspense of that sort of chase sequence, I suppose you would call it. You know, just. It really works, and it reminded me again, it's, you know, you're comparing it to some of the sort of top tier like films and things like that, but the Sergio Leone, that combination of the kind of the small motifs, like the kind of trill sounds, like the when someone turns up and it's like the kind of thing you might imagine you would hear, like someone sort of shaking a little maraca, like a wee two key thing on the piano, and the saloon next to like where the cowboys have turned up or whatever. It just has that sort of sets the scene, and I think that accompanies, again, it's a completely different setting, but that there's these gangs very visibly identifiable from different sort of factions, and they turn up, same with the sort of Leone, the Morricone soundtrack, and that those kinds of films where it's like very, very like epic on that scale, like even though, you know, it's set in like the desert or whatever, it just still, I felt like a connection there. I don't know if that was...
It's funny, again, it's like you don't realise, but maybe, I do think Western in a lot of way, like ponchos, like must be something exactly, like that. Not that I was like, oh, that's my Leone moment or whatever, but in the AD Kieran, that's when he's not heard the full score, but when he heard like bits for the trailer and he went, he says, that's dead, like Morricone and all, and I was like, well, I love that. So it's probably no coincidence that then I like tried to emulate it in some way, not consciously, but that's, I do feel that there's a lot of comparisons, the sort of stripped down location, but then the filled in like sonically, do you know what I mean? Like that's kind of, it must be what I'm thinking, the grand camera movements.
For sure, yeah. I that definitely came through for me, so.
Brilliant, man.
So yeah. So you get to the point of the film being finished, like 1 year writing, 3 years shooting, now it's done after 4 years. Like, how did you feel at that point? Did you feel amazing, or did you feel like almost empty, like I don't have something to now do?
Well, I did for a bit. I think it's really, really strange because like Gary, that was on like the Real Filthy, his podcast, and he was like asking, or like how does it feel, you know, that last day of shooting, it was like 3 years in a day it took to shoot, and I was like, I'd already edited like half the film, so I was just going back to editing. Then I was working on the sound design, then I was doing the score, so I wasn't really finished. And even like the final day submitting to the festival, then I'm just worrying and I'm like, okay, so now what have you got? Even though I'd showed people, like the boys were really, really positive about it, and they wouldn't like blow smoke, like they would say like, ah, well, good luck with that. Do you mean they would say it, and you mean like in a good way? And my wife, like, she wouldn't be like soft on it, and she was really like good about it. And I thought, okay, maybe, but then I thought, but they know, I mean, these guys know no films. I mean, they know films, and I'm like, so maybe I just don't know that much. Maybe I'm in over my head. So I worried about it, but then I was like, I was away with Nicola, and I was just sitting, like, and then I got the email to say, like, it's in. And then I was like, oh, well, that was a great moment. But I've started writing the next thing in between because I was like, okay, that's just another like kind of worry. You're like, say best thing happens and they say, great film, what do you want to do next? And you've got nothing.
You have something,
You're fucked, man.
Yeah.
You need to have something. So I'm writing the next thing just now. But it's hard with all this going on, but hopefully I'll get the head down and get it done.
Yeah. And how long did you wait from submission until finding out? Was that a long time?
It was a while. It was so strange as well because they'd actually reached out to me. Like, so the final deadline for the festival was like the 29th of October. And on the 28th at like 8 p.m., I've got like 80% uploaded, just ready to submit. It's a Film Freeway, the platform's called. And I was ready to submit. And they emailed me like out the blue and said, hi, I'd been like trying to get their attention on Twitter and stuff. Like, I posted the trailer, I'd posted the poster. I'd kind of mailed Alan Hunter. And I was like, but try to form some relationship, get on the radar. But I hadn't contacted them any other way after that. And then they emailed and they were like, hi, we're just like, we're the Glasgow Film Festival. We'd like to like find out about Angry Young Men. Is it finished? If so, we'd like to talk about potentially screening it. So they'd sort of put the feeler out. But then I'm worrying, I don't hear from them till mid-December. So it's like 6 weeks. And I'm thinking, that's the last email I got. And they've not said anything since. They hate it. Do you mean? So you're thinking the worst.
So you'd submitted it at that point then. So you're almost like, okay, maybe they thought the trailer, like young filmmaker, will reach out, but then they see it and you're thinking, oh no.
Exactly, man. And the same thing is like happening right now with a distributor who's like got in touch like, off the back of, they saw the trailer when the film festival was announced and they got in touch and they said, love the trailer, would love to talk about working with you. And the exact same thing happens. I send them a screener and it's like radio silence and I'm like, do they hate it? But then I'm like, the festival's going on, they're probably looking at so many films and it's like, who knows? But mate, it's so, see the head games, you need to just be so tunnel vision. Like I'm freaking out, but like you just do need to stay so calm about it.
Yeah. Hopefully, well, and then what I was going to ask them was, what was the, what is next? So you've referenced that you're working on it, and I suppose, as you say, your Angry Young Men's kind of coming to its conclusion, or maybe not conclusion because it's about to premiere, so that sounds like a strange term, but in terms of the work you have to do on it, and you're waiting to hear back from things like distributors, so you're working on something else, hopefully keeps your mind like thinking moving forward. So what I don't know if you want to tell too much about it, but
yeah, I can talk about it. Yeah. So it's going to be called Anyone Can Get It, and it's going to be, I'd ideally love to set it in Fairhill and just like pretty much where we shot. And the idea is it's going to be like, I don't know how good this sounds, but to me it sounds really good. It's sort of loosely based on like Frankenstein. And see the story of the Minotaur. You know that one? It's like a Greek tragedy, and it's like this.
I know what a Minotaur is, but I don't know the story.
That story. So it's like he was like So the Minotaur, it's like this, like Zeus or something came down, disguised himself as a bull or something, right, to this king, and like seduced the wife and ran away and all that. Then the king's son wanted to become the next king. It's really convoluted, right? But it basically comes down to like end up with this half bull, half man, and it's all because of like this curse from the gods. And it's like the bull ended up getting stuck in a labyrinth and all that, and it's like he got chastised. But I always felt like, in the same way I felt about like Shylock, in the same way I feel about like Frankenstein, they couldn't help who they are, and like they almost get chastised because they were just that wee bit different. So yeah, the idea is that that's based on like a son, and it's like two families sort of at war. But it'll be set in like that area, and I want to just make it like really exciting, and like it'll be a wee bit more brutal than Angry Young Men, but I really want to just like ramp up the sort of like adrenaline. So that's the idea for it. I don't know how good that sounds, but it will be good when I finish it.
Yeah, it sounds good. Obviously, yeah, see where you, what direction you go with it, like from that concept. So do you think it would have the same kind of scale as Angry Young Men? Are you
just, I think so. I think it's, in terms of cast size, it would be, I really would like the idea, like I've got costumes in mind, but I don't know how what I could do with budget wise of that. I've got costumes I'd like to like make and stuff. Like musically, I really want to ramp that up. And I think, to me, the scale wise, it will be like how the camera's used. I've got shots in mind that we need a bit of money for. But again, I really just want to maximise like camera steelo, how you move with the camera, so that'll still be there.
Interesting. Because yeah, I was wondering if after doing Angry Young Men, you would almost want to like retreat into maybe like a lot of interior scenes and things like that, because the outside is such a character again, like the camera movements, like the score. But I suppose that's almost, we've talked about different directors and the flourishes they use, but it's almost like part of like your kind of arsenal or whatever in terms of what you put into a film sounds like it's definitely that grand scale outside. And I think the camera work, again, that you've used could only be done outside in terms of the shots that I'm referencing, like the overhead shot and the just the sort of long tracking shots and with like the Raymond scene and stuff like that. So it sounds like that's part of your kind of makeup in terms of a director.
I think that's what I discovered as well. What you don't realise, that that's the kind of stuff I like. Mm. And I think I've realised, I mean, who knows? I mean, in a few films' time or whatever, maybe I would like to do something intimate and something like nostalgic. But I think, to me anyways, I mean, I don't know what the audience reaction would be, but to me it'd be like, if you like this film, then it's on you to like not reproduce the film, but include, because I enjoy it first and foremost, but then from an audience point of view, I'd love to give them that again, but in a different, totally different setting, and give them like get big emotions. Like that's, I do feel like that's sort of like my, like what I'd want to, if I was like, my top priority would to be make it bold and exciting, and I think I'd make it intense. Mm. I don't think it'd be like a highly nuanced piece. Do you mean, I don't think that's the type of filmmaker I am. I'm not like very like a kind of better with broader strokes. Do you know what I mean? So that's what I'd like to go for and create something exciting.
Great. Okay, so when have you got an end date for writing it, or are you still really fleshing it out?
I'm still I've got like 80 pages or something, and I've got a lot of key scenes, the same way I did with Angry Young Men, but it'll be a lot quicker writing it this time, because that was really trying to figure out how to write a film in the first place, not just like one film. So I think once the festival's by with, I'll see what the kind of lay the land is, but then it's just head down, and then I'll just need to like treat it like training and be like 4 hours a day and just keep doing it and see where we go. But if people show interest, then that's another great pressure to get it finished, so hopefully.
And is there any lessons from Angry Young Men? Like, so, you know, as I asked, did you write it with what am I capable of in terms of with what you've got sort of to use to make the film, and then having made the actual film, having shot it over 3 years, did you learn anything that you've sort of taken into the next one?
I think how to shoot and like shoot days and stuff like that, and who you need there and when and how to run a set. I think
it's more about the product, the sort of filming process rather than how you write it.
I think so, because I think like, to me really, I mean, where's the most money going on a film? Like, you pay everyone, if you've got stars, that's going to cost a lot. Mm. But then to me, it's like the most effects I'll probably have. I'm saying that, I don't know. Because you never know what gets classed as stunts. Do you know what I mean? Like, a simple thing to me, like a quad bike's like a kind of thing in this new film. To me, that may be a huge expense. Like, I don't really know, because I've never worked with a budget. But I just think, like, I'm not writing like CG films. I'm not writing period pieces, really. But even though I want to kind of create my own costumes and create a world in itself, it's not like a Tim Burton film. I'm not like painting sets and stuff. I want to use it's a combination. I want to use the locations, but then alter it slightly. So I don't think it would cost too much. And my big goal, I've got like a few cast in mind that I would love to have, but I would love to have like an open call and get like new faces and like get all these new characters, like not just like actors, not just theatre school people, mix that. One of the things Pricey said was like mixing the pros with like the people, blending them exactly, and it's such a great idea. But I just want to see like all faces, and like I want to just see all sort of characters, and I want to put them all in it. But I would love to have like David O'Hara, Rory McCann, Stephen McCall, and James McAvoy. I don't know, the four of them just keep popping my head for this film, so we'll see. But if not, then I don't think it'll be a hugely expensive film.
Great. So there's roles there that you're kind of thinking of as those four roles, and mm-hmm. see what happens with it.
Aye. And cool. Then there'll be a lot of, there's a really like strong leading like woman part, mm-hmm. and there'll be others as well.
Yeah. Cool. Well, hopefully Glasgow Film Festival can catch the likes of James McAvoy's attention and get him roped in.
Hopefully, cool. Mate. Hopefully.
Well, thanks for doing this. Good luck with the festival, and good luck with the next one as well. Can't wait to see it.
Thanks, mate. Great chat. Thank you.
Cheers. I'm only one step ahead of heartbreak, one step ahead of misery. One step.